Yes. I recently released a video in which I asked 100 content creators about their favorite memories from FF14's most recent expansion, Endwalker. I'm very proud of how that video came out. It took a lot, and I mean a lot, of work to create, both in terms of piecing together the unscripted answers from the creators into a coherent story, to editing, to coordinating and obtaining the voice or video clips in the first place. There's a lot crammed into its 41-minute runtime, but there's one thing that's very distinctly missing. And no, it wasn't a bald head shining resplendent like the sun. It's me. I basically didn't insert myself or my opinions at all into my video because I didn't want the video to be about me. This video, however, seeing as the end of Endwalker is fast approaching, I'm going to be doing a whole lot of yapping today. We're going to take a journey through Endwalker's main raiding content and job design choices, breaking them down, and discussing the expansion, good and bad, in what I hopefully feel is a fairly balanced manner. I think everybody comes from a different point of view and experience, and I love hearing individual opinions on the expansion as a whole, especially from those that focus on different types of content to the ones that I have a more critical eye with. So, let's get into it. This should be an interesting one. I want to get started by discussing something that I know is a point of contention for players right now, and on the whole, I have a lot of opinions about the Endwalker iteration of. The jobs. I think the best way I can condense the way that jobs play in Endwalker into one singular word is divisive. This expansion we saw a doubling down in the concepts and design decisions that initially took place in Shadowbringers, with every job for all intents and purposes becoming a gauge job, and the majority of the rotational decisions that you make stemming from the building and spending of that gauge in the right places and cadences. This was emphasized alongside a reduction in complexity and decision making for individual jobs. Previously, learning a job came with a lot more extra steps than I feel they have now, because most of them would have their own multi-layered language that you'd need to learn and work around, and to say it bluntly, their own jank that came as part of the challenge of mastering them. Now jobs are much more clean, but in exchange, much more cookie cutter. Two new jobs are added in Sage and Reaper. We also saw three reworks in the forms of Monk, Summoner, and later down the road Paladin. So let's use the three of them as an example. Summoner went for a job that was an amalgamation of a lot of dissonant parts. Dot usage, primal summoning, positioning, proc management, maximizing wormwave usages and more. It was complex and rewarding, but thematically, it was a bit of a mess. In its place, we got this very tight, simple, focused design, a job that was categorically an improvement thematically and aesthetically, but in terms of gameplay itself, it had become a very different beast entirely, instead taking the form of this 60-second looper rotational where the order in which you press buttons doesn't even matter too much on a very base level as long as you press them. Heck, you spend over 80% of your time with free movement. This mentality can be expanded to FF14 job design on the whole. Components of your rotation that can be seen as pain points to newer players, like Kaiten, God rest its soul, were eschewed in favor of making jobs easy to ease yourself into, nice to look at, and relatively painless to learn, for the most part. One little side note I want to make about Summoner here is that often I actually think that people oversimplify it. There are a few kind of interesting optimizations you can make on Summoner, even though they're not super complex by and of themselves. The issue is, and this is also an issue with a lot of jobs in this game right now, that making those optimizations gains you so little damage that it's almost not worth doing. It's almost just worth farming for crits instead in order to optimize that damage. And I think that, if anything, the skill floor and the skill ceiling are crushing a little bit too close to one another as FF14 develops over time. Monk is one of a few jobs that don't really follow traditional structure, and I found myself more and more drawn to those standouts like Black Mage and Monk as times have gone on. What makes Monk rewarding is that it reminds me of the priority systems of old, where you have a ton of options and sometimes there's enough going on all at once that it isn't immediately obvious which decision you should be making without a lot of experience or prior planning. Even its burst windows are interesting, having a free-flowing nature to them, and the requirement to potentially enter your Riddle of Fire windows on different GCDs, leading to slightly different rotations to execute those windows properly. I guess to condense what I enjoy about Monk down, is that it's a job which has a lot of moment-to-moment decision-making in order to play optimally, which leads to a lot of theory-crafting potential and, more importantly for me, experimentation. It's not as simple as I do my 1-2-3 and spend my gauge and then I'm mostly done, which is absolutely the case for an ever-increasing number of the game's jobs. Obviously, there's one glaring issue, which is the fact that unless you have JP ping or resort to illegal third-party tools, you often can't effectively double weave on Monk, which is a bad, bad thing. Monk has procs that ideally need to be spent immediately to avoid overcap in the Forbidden Chakra, and in burst windows you have other off-globals to press, leading sometimes to mandatory clipping. This is one of the standout examples of what's at this point been confirmed by Yoshi P, that the developers do not really account for ping when designing jobs, and it's something that I hope is given a little bit more attention going forward. Paladin receives sweeping changes mid-expansion, mainly as a direct result of one of Endwalker's largest job design changes, the condensation of raid buffs from being on multiple timers to all lining up exactly on the 2-minute window. I think this was simultaneously the best and worst change made to job design this entire expansion, depending on how you look at it. It raises the skill floor by a country mile, making it much more difficult for new players to become deadweight. It lowers the importance of composition or fitting jobs correctly together in a party in a cohesive way, making PF a lot friendlier, and fitting every job into a simple cookie cutter allows balancing to be done much more efficiently. That's good. The bad is that it's boring in comparison to that which came before, from the point of view of an experienced raider. I enjoyed that certain encounters essentially gave preferential treatment to certain jobs and compositions. I was in favor of the theoretical situation in which people would want to swap jobs from fight to fight, based on how strong they were in each. Even though, in practice, admittedly, that was rarely ever a thing that panned out, I just wanted the armory system to become more intrinsic to the raiding experience. I think you're probably noticing that I'm very much a big fan of risk-reward and player choice, and in bringing every job in line with a 2-minute burst, it meant that something there was lost for people like me. Paladin is one of the great victims here. Initially a job that didn't have a major spiky burst window, instead having relatively consistent damage across their 60-second cycle, with a lot of their optimization coming from spreadsheeting fight or flight usage and the like. It was very different to the other tanks, but with the 2-minute meta currently in place, a job without a spiky burst just doesn't really have a place, it's not quite as good, and the results showed. So Square Enix fixed it, bringing it in line with other jobs, and it was really the only thing they could do without reverting their big raid buff shift. It's just a shame, because I know a lot of paladins that played it for that exact gameplay style, and now that exact gameplay style is gone. I think that on the whole, it's actually a good thing to have easier jobs like Reaper and Summoner, and more difficult jobs like Black Mage and Monk. I think that having more quote-unquote beginner classes and more quote-unquote expert jobs can be a pretty good thing on the whole, and I have a feeling Square Enix may go a little further in that direction. For me, the sweet spot in job design was actually during Stormblood. While I enjoyed Heavensward immensely, it was very clear that the developers were still finding their feet, and despite it being very engaging in terms of how much complexity there was, jank and imbalance reigned. Stormblood implemented the first job gauges, not across the board, just on those that it made sense on. They did a huge cutback on button bloat that was definitely a thing prior, and they prioritized simplicity. Jobs became easier to play, but they were not all the same, and each had a bunch of different optimizations you could do on them. Miasma 2 on Scholar is a great example that I'll constantly bring up. Actually, I've written 4 scripts in the past week, and I think I referenced Miasma 2 in 3 of them. I'm so sorry. Miasma 2 is a melee-only DPS dot which you could essentially use whenever you wanted for a damage gain, but it cost a lot of MP. This gave you an interesting decision to make on how much mana you could safely burn on damage, and when you could push into melee to use it. There was also a huge emphasis on situational party utility, like Mana Shift and Apoc being roll actions, and honestly, I really miss those. My hope is that in Dawntrail, we keep the tight, well-targeted, focused designs that are in place in the current state of FF14, but that new abilities add a little bit of extra depth to a few of those jobs that are very much wanting. Ideally, we don't just get an extra off-global on a 60-second cooldown to press that does damage. Instead, I would like to get something that is very useful, but you have to think a little deeper about its usage beyond button light up I press. I'm going to talk a lot more in depth about healers later in the video because I have a lot to say, but it's better saved in my opinion until we've discussed our next topic. We're going to talk about Extreme, Savage, and Ultimate in order. Endwalker's raids are pretty interesting on the whole, and I think more and more they've shifted to center stage in terms of the attention and discourse surrounding them. And I have a few home truths for people that I'm sure will be disagreed with both positive and negative things to say about Endwalker's raid series on the whole. Endwalker's extreme trials, I think, were very hit or miss, and in truth, I think that's actually a good thing. What they pushed especially hard on this expansion was using extremes as a medium to explore a particular concept, puzzle, or mechanical sequence that often isn't seen anywhere else. Fights like Rubicante introduce very unique challenges, which are sometimes great, sometimes fairly unenjoyable to execute, but I'm happy they exist on the whole. We see this concept especially being the case in Zodiark, Rubicante, and to a lesser extent in Zeromus, with sprinkles of more traditional encounters in the forms of Hydaelyn and Barbariccia. I think the biggest issue with a lot of extreme fights right now are the sheer number of repeats. I get why they've done this, it's a nightmare, when new bespoke mechanics are just flat out easily skippable with a little extra gear, so often they like to use repeats to avoid wasting design time, but they feel kind of egregious in the extreme trial encounters this expansion. I'd love to see something a little more in terms of volume of the number of unique mechanics in an extreme fight, or more randomization in terms of the order in which things occur to keep the fights feeling fresh for the often 50 plus clears of farm you need to do for them. On the whole, I think it's fair to say that Barbariccia was the strongest of Endwalker's extreme encounters. This is due to a few things. Pacing firstly, because for an introductory endgame battle, it's quick. Boss AoEs are fast and punishing, back to back to back to back to back, with multiple patterns of mechanics to pay attention to, and dodges which take care and attention to successfully keep up time on. There's a decent selection of mechanics, and while repeats do happen, there's enough of a variety to keep you interested. More than that though, as a healer, Barbariccia on release dealt a surprising amount of damage in an interesting variety of cadences. There was chip damage that led into heavier hits that could easily take an unprepared raid unawares, enough raid-wide to necessitate you spacing your cooldowns, and it was so easy for people to pick up vault stacks and need quick spot heals to survive. It was the first extreme in a long time, in my opinion, that felt interesting to heal, even if you're an experienced long-term healer. More of this, please. Now, when we come to Savage, I think I'm somewhat of an evangelist. I think a lot of this expansion was very, very enjoyable to progress and even to reclear. Let's go a little more in depth because I think there's a discussion to be had here. The first thing I want to say on a positive note is that I adore the increasing commitment to more interesting arena shapes. It was long a complaint of FF14 raid design that we basically only got circular arenas with nothing else to them, for years on end, and while static circle or square arenas still make up a decent percentage, this expansion in Savage we saw entries like Pandemonium and Aegisthus, as well as certain mechanics within Athena that acted as a very welcome mix-up. The arena is, or rather should be, part of the challenge in any boss fight, and I know that for me at least, the engagement I felt of having interactable elements in earlier encounters was something I sorely missed. It doesn't even need to be solely in terms of shape either. For example, A5S has this tower in the middle of the arena, and upon standing inside it, you charge the syringes around the edges of the arena to allow you to transform into birds, monkeys, or remove mechanic-specific debuffs. It was cool, and it meant that you weren't just fighting a boss. You were managing your resources and space in the arena as well. I'm hoping to see these concepts further expanded upon in Dawntrail. Overall, I very much enjoyed the majority of Endwalker's Savage offerings. I think that encounter design in FF14 is one of its greatest strengths. Fights are usually complex, cinematic, and engaging. I like them so much that I'm more than happy to farm them weekly, to join party finders and help folk clear, and to come back for them years after release and still have a blast. The fourth turns were especially strong, and I genuinely believe that all three, if we factor in both the door bosses and final bosses, deserve to be considered classics alongside favourites like Brute Justice and God Kefka. And yes, I'm including PAS in that statement. I also think that the statement I've seen going round stating that everything is just limit cut is quite reductive and unhelpful. The limit cut iconography is a way of showing that X will happen in a given order, and at this point it's used to telegraph a whole host of different things in game that are unique both in challenge and in execution from one another. It's not fair to say everything is limit cut when every limit cut presents a different solution. That said, I do feel that the developers have kind of fallen into certain comfortable habits when it comes to filler mechanic design. Often they'll present an arena or boss hazard, and in order to make it more difficult, they'll just simply add, oh, and also a stack or spread to it. I think that's a little uninteresting when it comes up multiple times in every single fight, and I think this is a lot more egregious than any kind of limit cut debacle. Speaking of gripes, I was not a fan of the increasing hitbox sizes, or of the removal of positionals in some cases, unless they explicitly aided in the mechanical design of the fight. Let's take P2S Hippocampus as an example of this being done right. The limited space in the room when the water has flowed in makes for a cool scenario where the party is the box surrounding the boss, and you're constantly on the move because so much of the floor space is being rendered a danger zone on a regular basis. It's cool, and positionals would reduce the fun factor of the challenge that's already present, so I think removing them was the perfect choice. Now let's look at another boss where I feel that hitbox size was a negative thing. P6S was a humanoid boss with a hitbox the size of Narnia. And why? Because in my opinion, reducing the hitbox size drastically could present much more interesting solutions and strategies for melee to keep up time with the current mechanics that are in the fight right now. Having it at that size didn't add anything particularly positive, so why would it be there in the first place? I know the FF14 community is definitely split on their stance as to whether positional should remain or not, but just to make my stance clear, throw my hat in the ring, I like them on the whole, and I think they should remain. Casters have to deal with movement and slide casting constraints. Melee have to deal with positional and uptime constraints. It feels like there's somewhat of a balance here, and I don't think that should leave. I'm also not the biggest fan of the encounter design philosophy Square Enix have been using for third fights for quite a while now. I felt that Aegistus was outright the weakest encounter in all of Pandemonium, with Themis and Phoenix both being extremely mid. The issue I have with all three of these fights is that they don't really get going until at least halfway through their runtime. Typical FF14 design philosophy revolves around showing you a few mechanics to teach you their rules. So for example, with Themis, we learn about his light and dark attacks, and we learn how they correlate to each of his standard ability casts. Then once they've taught you the rules of engagement, they begin to experiment with it and to start to phase in more complex set pieces or combinations of multiple mechanics. You can use Harvests from P7S as an example of this. And this is great and all, but it's getting to the point where the rules of engagement are taking 5 or 6 minutes of encounter time to teach. And during that time, very little is interesting or engaging to execute after the first handful of pulls. P7S is the most egregious example, because by the time the mechanics really start getting going, you're already deep within skippable with gear territory. We really need the difficulty spike of these encounters to come earlier, and to see more experimentation and pushing the concept of the core mechanics closer to their limits than what we get right now. I also want to make a small mention to the fact that we well and truly saw the resurgence of door bosses once again in Dawn Trail. All three final encounters utilized them, and all three times I think they were well used. I've always been fairly neutral on whether they should exist or not, though if they do insist on using them, I'm adamant that the door bosses should drop upgrade materials. I hope in Dawn Trail we'll see a bit more variety on door bosses versus fully fledged final battles. I was a big fan of the fact that in Shadowbringers we got a real variety of final bosses, with Titan giving us one single boss HP bar but with numerous forms and fight styles, the straight encounter of Shiva, and then the multiple bosses from Eden's Promise and Oracle of Darkness. I'm about to say something that definitely goes against the grain as well. I liked the tight execution check that the PAS door boss provided week 1. Before I explain my opinion in depth, I guess I should clarify the position I come from. I did the encounter week 1, my group did not have a problem with the check at all. The first time we did the door boss cleanly, it died. We didn't have a perfectly optimal comp, nor did we need one, but we had planned ahead to bring Black Mage to the fourth turn for the additional damage they bring, which clearly ended up paying off for us. Checks as tight as the PAS door boss do not come along very often, and they do not remain as challenging as they are for very long. The lovely thing about Savage is that any check that exists can only really exist for the first 2 weeks or so of a tier. Many progging the turn have access to enough tomestone weapons and additional gear pieces that even the tightest checks become manageable and doable by week 3. I think that having a variety of types of fight across a raid series is a very good thing. I love puzzle fights that rack the brain. I love fights that are easier mechanically but are combined with a tight execution check, and I love everything in between. I think that Hephaestus exists on this spectrum in a similar place to where Shiva did in Shadowbringers. A fight that wasn't super challenging to solve for the most part, but mechanics themselves had very strict timings and harsh failure states, coupled with a fairly tight check that pushed your group to test those timings to the limit to make sure you could break through. I am firmly of the belief that the checks present in Hephaestus Phase 1 were challenging but fair, and that in order for your group composition to be the real core issue for your failure, you'd need to bring multiple, and no, I don't mean one or two, I mean 3 to 5 of the weakest jobs of their respective roles to make it the primary difference maker. In most cases, the real issue was that one or more members of the group were simply not pulling their weight in terms of damage contribution, which then forced the others to play to their utmost limits, or maybe swap job to gain the couple of hundred DPS that their other player wasn't bringing due to incorrect play. I've always been a fan of comping playing a part in prog, and for these encounters having access to a Black Mage pick is definitely advantageous, but it was not a deal breaker. Don't get me wrong, I don't think every fight should be like this, but having one or two per expansion that really test your capability to do your rotation well under pressure is to me a fun challenge for those that aim to blind or early prog. For everyone else, guides and gear will make it much more accessible and friendly within just a few weeks. I fear that the strong backlash that it received will cause an overcorrection, which we already saw to an extent with the excessively lenient turn 4 checks in Anabasios. Speaking of door bosses, we got 3 of them in Endwalker, and that's certainly interesting. The door boss debate has been going back and forth for a long time now. The plus side is that you essentially get 5 encounters per raid tier, each mechanically and aesthetically distinct. With depth and timelines and things to perfect and practice, you get 2 pieces of content for the price of 1, and that's just great. The downside is, do you really? When the final turn of a Savage tier has a door boss instead of a singular 11 to 13 minute encounter with a full build-up, structure and payoff, you receive 2 6 to 8 minute encounters. It sounds like a good trade, because you're getting like what, 16 minutes of fight instead of the alternative? The problem is that usually these encounters also factor in repeats much more heavily, often showcasing just one or two key concepts and then toying with them in creative ways for the rest of the runtime. For me personally, I quite like door bosses, aside from the fact that they should have loot drops of their own. Give us additional upgrade material items from those in Dawn Trail, please, I'm begging you. What I don't like is when door bosses become an expectation. I remember in Heaven's Ward when there were rumblings of a secret hidden phase in A8S. Brute Justice transforms! He gets wings! There's a secret phase after you beat him, where you fight winged Brute Justice in his final form. This was mind-blowing to the player base, something truly special and exciting. Then when Stormblood released and we got our first ever true door boss, upon pushing X-Death to 60%, instead of continuing the encounter, he gets sucked into the abyss and the transition begins. We get to witness the miracle of birth as Neo X-Death breaks free and tears the walls of the universe itself open to face us. And it's fucking sick. Do you want to know why it's so cool? Because it's unexpected, because it's new. But then incorporating door bosses again and again and again over the coming years dulls its sheen, makes it a given, and makes those moments lose the impact they once had. The only time I've really felt that spark of excitement during a transition was, ironically, when there wasn't a door boss at all. Eden Titan, which I think is arguably the closest FF14 has ever come to creating a perfect Savage fight, Titan transitioning into maximum at around 70%, while cool by its own right, was so special because it subverted your expectations. You as a player have been conditioned to expect a checkpoint, a reset, and a fresh HP bar, but instead, after a flashy entrance, the fight just resumes. It's so cool, and I think the Eden Raids really hit the sweet spot in regards to their fourth turn structure. We had Titan and Shiva, neither of which had door bosses, but Titan felt like it compounded the structures of door bosses and non-door bosses into one. And then we got Oracle of Darkness and Eden's Promise to fulfill that door boss format we'd come to expect and appreciate. In Dawntrail, I want to see our expectations subverted again. Please experiment more. Please give us at least one tier with no door boss too. Thank you. Now is the part of the video where I talk about healers and healing in conjunction with raid encounters, and probably make a lot of people angry in the process. Healing in FF14 right now is not as interesting or rewarding as it used to be. I consider that not a matter of opinion, but a matter of fact. This is a fairly complex issue, and it factors into why so many long-term healer mains are feeling a sense of apathy towards their favourite role. I've seen the argument being proliferated that healing is just too easy now, but it isn't as simple as that. That's a massively reductive statement when a lot of the issues with healers stem from a mixture of fight design and job design, because those two components are so interlinked when a large percentage of the role's gameplay is reliant on the constraints of the encounter. A monk is going to be doing that same core rotation on any fight, and making minor changes based on uptime and phase change requirements. A scholar is going to be pressing completely different healing buttons on a fight-to-fight basis, and their level of engagement will rely on the opportunities to optimize or feel smart within that fight. This is somewhat of an issue when every expansion, healers get a stronger and stronger core healing kit to deal with almost every incoming situation. Previously, managing to get through an entire fight without your healers needing to expend GCDs on their healing was challenging. You had limited tools, and using those tools came with an opportunity cost. I'll explain that in a moment. Now you have so many tools that often they're just sat on cooldown for extended periods of time in all but the hardest one or two fights of any given tier, ready to deal with incoming damage in a moment's notice. The use of your baseline spells like Medica 2 and Sucker have been relegated to a failure state, or an excessive safety tool in progression, rather than an integral part of the kit. It feels like healer job design hasn't yet caught up to reflect the quality of life changes they've received in Endwalker, and to a lesser extent in Shadowbringers. Let's use the half-caste being added to Broiland Glare as an example. So Scholar and White Mage healing in Shadowbringers, and even beforehand, came with an opportunity cost to healing. You refreshed your dot every 30 seconds, and aside from those few reliable windows, you had very limited weave opportunities to get those off-global heals off. White Mage would use their Swiftcast or Afflatus heals to provide those windows, eating into their movement and GCD healing resources, meaning that you often thought about when you'd do them quite carefully, hoping to double dip and gain the absolute most out of every window you gave yourself. Scholar had access to Ruin too, but in order to make Ruin 2 not a DPS loss, you'd aim to fit in an energy drain as well, giving a weight to each and every usage for weaving and making you think twice about your decisions. These job mechanics gave a lot of thought to the micro of your movement and healing moment to moment. In Endwalker, they gave Glare and Broil half casts, meaning you can weave whenever you want. From a quality of life perspective, that's excellent and much more beginner friendly. But in terms of engagement, you just cleaved out a massive chunk of what people enjoyed about those jobs, and there hasn't been something added to replace them. On top of this, healers are becoming simpler and simpler every expansion in terms of their DPS rotation. I know, healer DPS rotations, yep, it's time to laugh. I think to an extent, that's good. I felt that Heavensward Cleric stance was limiting, and it felt like it posed more situations in which the player felt punished, rather than scenarios in which they could excel and feel smart. But when it comes to things like multiple dots on different timers, Miasma 2, cast times, weave limitations, buff extensions and more, they've been eradicated piecemeal, with nothing being added to take up that brain space for the player. So, DPSing as healers has gotten easier, the number of and uniqueness of healing job mechanics has reduced, with nothing to take their place, and healers across the board have received more and more tools to make their responsibilities friendlier to accomplish. For new players, that's good, but for the person that wants a little more, you only have a few choices. You can either do speedruns and push your jobs to the absolute limit, doing some insane shit, all in the hopes of feeling something. Or you can play Astro. As a little aside for Astro, I can totally see why it's getting a rework. People often categorize healers into reactive and proactive, and split regen and barrier healers firmly between those two. Not only is that just flat out completely wrong, and frankly a kind of silly way of thinking, it helps us frame how different Astro is to the other three healers in FF14 right now. Efficient healing is proactive healing, on every job, and reactive healing is generally reserved for dealing with situations where something in your pull goes wrong and for dealing with damage variants. But Astro takes this to an extreme. Instead of proactivity being an optimal way to play in most content, but reactive healing being a decent stopgap for all but the hardest content, on Astro, it's a requirement. Astro has so many setup abilities like Earthly Star, Horoscope, and Macrocosmos that are categorically just bad, without prior knowledge of the fight's mechanics, timings, and damage profiles. Without making use of them, the job just kinda sucks. It's rewarding, and it's fun, but it's at odds with the design decisions the job team has made time and time again in regards to the other three healers. This is why we're getting some kind of course correction in Dawntrail. That and the fact that I don't think they have any idea what to do with cards and they're just kind of throwing ideas at a wall every expansion until one of them sticks. Ast is a job with an extremely high skill ceiling right now from optimal card play, and with failure states in regards to healing being absolutely possible for the average player. And that, sadly, is a dying breed. Now we're going to talk about the Omega Protocol. A clear of the Omega Protocol was achieved without healers on release patch, and I think many of the commenters I saw had absolutely no idea as to why this was a problem, instead opting to say, lol, healers bad. Firstly, let's just make this clear that this was a massive achievement. 99% of you that are watching this video, you cannot do this. Sorry. It took 8 excellent players, an extended period of practice, strategy, and composition tuning, and a bit of luck, to piece together the winning formula that got them through. Non-healer jobs have received so many varied healing and mitigative tools that something like this happening eventually was kind of inevitable. Their victory should be praised. That said, it raises an interesting discussion. Why are FF14 damage profiles so generic? Why have we fallen into a pattern with raids where you'll have a 2-3 hit tank buster that requires a swap in between, where major raid damages come out every 30-60 seconds, and in between those windows, you'll have a break to do mechanics? For finales, you can use the patent-pending mitigation macro with minor changes and just slap it in and it works just fine. The issue with FF14 healing in encounters isn't the raw numbers of damage coming out. Those are actually completely fine. It's with the type and cadence of damage. What I want from this is Square Enix to think about it, experiment, and honestly just go a little crazy with it. I want tank busters that just smack the tank 10 times in a row. No forced tank swaps, just bang, 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 bang. Oh, your cooldowns aren't enough? Deal with it. Bring us back to a time where you'd regularly tank swap to make use of both tanks' cooldowns, rather than simply doing so when a buster forces you to. Make autos hit harder. Give us cool mechanical auto attacks like those present in Hephaestus' second phase, but also factor in normal autos more too. I want more spot healing more regularly. We have so many single target healing tools. Make us use them on more than just the tanks or to heal Johnny Six Vulns. I want more regular raid damage, repeated raid damage, and more than all of those, unique raid damage. Give us an entire phase where you just get hit every 10 seconds. And the only way to deal with it without spamming GCD heals is to plan everything perfectly over the course of multiple minutes. Give us mechanics that allow us to choose when the damage comes out, that put that control in the hands of the player and see what solutions they come up with. Give us random instances of damage with a tell so that you can't purely spreadsheet everything, but you do have a few seconds to react in advance. I want the devs to push us harder and to have more fun with the way that they design healing challenges, because that's what we need as healers. Challenges. This is where we harken back to what I said about Barbary Cheer Extreme having a surprising edge for healers in just how quickly damage came out, and how it mixed up heavy raid hits and chip damage in an interesting way. I want to feel that more every raid tier. I think that starting in Shadowbringers and being further exemplified in Endwalker, we've seen a drastic shift in the balance of FF14 difficulty design in the whole. Before, jobs were extremely complex, and the challenge was to play them around the constraints of each and every encounter, which could be challenging by their own right, but would usually follow common rules or threads. But over time, jobs have flat out become easier to play, their rules have condensed and their common thread lines have become more standardized. The juggling of before has become an on-rails experience with occasional deviations. But Final Fantasy XIV has not gotten easier. It's because encounter design is drastically increasing in complexity every expansion. Compare Brute Justice to current expansion, or even to Hello World from Stormblood, and the difference is striking. As players face and overcome challenges, the devs need to constantly outdo themselves and present something harder and harder to keep up with an ever-improving player base. And so they do. Each expansion gets exponentially harder, mechanically, to keep up with the power creep of player skill. Endwalker encounters are excellent, it's just that the root of those challenges come from a very different place than they did just a handful of years ago. Instead of a balance of job and fight design, difficulty is now massively skewed in favor of the challenges that come from the fight. The culmination of that has created what I feel is FF14's best fight. Dragonsong's Reprise Ultima is FF14 at its best. Despite being delayed for so long that it ended up releasing an entire expansion late, when it finally came out, it subverted the expectations of what players know of Ultimates from the very first lockout of blind progression. That is, it throws us a checkpoint after just over 2 minutes of encounter, telling us that everything that came before is just a prelude that doesn't even matter. I'm not going to sit here for too long talking about this fight, but what I will say is that DSR came very close to perfecting the formula of melding storytelling with gameplay in a raid encounter. Every phase has environmental and peripheral storytelling, with the NPC dialogue, and even to the literal buffs you obtain from phases, tying into the storyline of the Dragonsong War. The world race was so engaging because spectators were enthralled, simply due to the fact that they wanted to know what comes next. How would this alternative timeline reach its fruition? Would we save him? Should we save him in the first place? They took a moment in FF14 history that was important to the players and capitalized on it to create a compelling narrative that blind progression raiders would become the storytellers of, showcasing the way that this all plays out to their viewers and spectators. The fingerprints of the emotions we connect with those storylines can be felt throughout all of DSR's 18-minute runtime. DSR was also the moment in Endwalker that I feel marked a turning point. It was harder than anything that had come before it, significantly so, with numerous 8-man body checks, failure states, and also a massive reduction in role-targeted mechanics. Now anybody can get anything, for the most part. This instantly increases the number of possible outcomes each person can have to deal with more error potential and more memorization each member needs to undertake. It's a good way of instantly increasing the difficulty of a mechanic, without needing to take it to the next level in terms of sheer complexity. And it's a thread line we see it keep in common with second Endwalker Ultimate, the Omega Protocol. By the way, I made a literal 90-minute video on this too, so you can literally just go watch it if you want to. I want to defend the Omega Protocol for a moment. I do not think it is a badly designed fight. In fact, I quite like it. It's not without its problems, and I don't feel like it ever really rises quite to the heights that Dragon Song's Reprise delivered us, but through it, we get to experience quite possibly the coolest final phase in FF14 history, allowing us to live out the Limit Break War fantasy that every player has always thought at least once. Damn, that would be cool. To a lesser extent, it also takes the base game story and further embellishes on it, with an entirety of the latter half of the fight being purely seated in fanfiction as Omega harnesses the power of Dynamis to reach even greater heights. Thematically, it's super cool, and it definitely deserves a place at the podium. Mechanically, it feels like a logical progression from the rules that DSR implemented. Almost every mechanic is role agnostic, and you need to learn all possible responsibilities and be ready to perform them at a moment's notice. Often, a single death will force a wipe state, making your progression cycle painfully slow until all 8 players can consistently execute each of those possibilities. The checks aren't tight enough to pose a major problem, but absolutely are close enough to force a level of stress, as long as everyone survives, that is. There's definitely a whole discussion to be had on Phase 5 of Top, as you gain Dynamis stacks on each party member carefully and painstakingly, and whether the subsequent explosion of auto-marker usage that resulted from the way that mechanic plays out is healthy. And for that one guy, no, I'm sorry, that's not going to happen in this video. That's right, I teased you and then disappointed you in moments, wait till next time. But I feel like in a lot of ways, there are common thread lines between both DSR and Top in the way they approach and dish out challenges. And those thread lines are direct evolutions and direct complications from those we got in the Epic of Alexander and Shadowbringers. That makes me, on the whole, endlessly excited to see what kind of direct evolution is going to be shown to us next expansion with the impending introduction of Future's rewritten Ultimate in 7.1. The future is bright, and maybe lessons learned this time around will help Square Enix build an experience that could topple Dragon Song's Reprise as the finest content FF14 has to offer. We also got a third pillar to raiding in Endwalker to stand alongside Savage and Ultimate in the form of Criterion. Criterion was interesting. Players have been begging for Savage Dungeons for almost as long as I can remember, and while the implementation likely isn't quite what the majority were expecting, I can honestly say that I believe some of the bosses found in the 3 Criterion offerings are amongst the most interesting new additions in Endwalker on the whole. There's a much lower barrier to entry present than that for both Savage and Ultimate. In Criterion, normal that is, you need simply 4 players with at least crafted or equivalent gear and a bit of time. Each of the 3 dungeons follows an exact formula. 3 boss battles with 2 trash packs between that offer their own unique challenges. The trash mobs are interesting, not only because they can one-shot your party if you look at them the wrong way, but because their pathing, environment, and their telegraphs or lack of them force you into less than ideal scenarios and offer decision-making challenges to deal with them. So you can't just pull everything at once. That's going to end horribly. So you need to designate targets and carefully plan your course of action as a group. It's fun, rewarding, and a breath of fresh air to experience trash mobs that feel intimidating. The bosses are just peak as well. They never overstay their welcome. Often, a 4-ish minute runtime gives them the opportunity to showcase their unique mechanic, build upon that mechanic in a few interesting ways, and then fall to you. There's no filler, no repeat phases, just a steady build-up in complexity and challenge until either you or them is dead. It's absolutely great. Whether it's the speed of Moko the Restless, the mind-melting puzzles that run through Alo Alo, or the dreaded teleportation mechanic in Sildin Subterrane that was an absolute menace, until the Easy Strat was proliferated. Each offers unique challenges with a bunch of different patterns which you just don't really find elsewhere in FF14. I'm so glad that we're getting more in Dawntrail. I know there was a large debate on the reward structure being an issue for these, and to an extent I agree, although it's kind of secondary to me. I've spoken about it in a previous video, but I think an easy fix going forward is to keep those glowy tombstone weapons that you could get from Alo Alo, but make them a direct one-to-one trade rather than needing any additional investment or requirements to obtain. And also, make doing your criterion an additional route to obtain upgrade materials and further ease that painful throttle. We're definitely trending in the right direction though, as of Alo Alo. So going back to my initial question I posed in the title, was Endwalker a good FF14 expansion for raiding? Yeah, I think it was. We got an entirely new type of content that was exhilarating and fun. We got the best fight the game has ever seen in the form of Dragonsong's Reprise. Savage was still good, as long as we don't count Odysseus, and I liked a lot more of the encounters than I disliked. Extreme Trials continue to be exceptionally hit or miss, but when they hit hard. We got a lot of good, and we learned a lot as a community, improved a lot as a community, and with Dawntrail promising more things to do than ever before, there's a lot for us to look forward to. I'm excited personally. I hope we see somewhat of a course correction in terms of job design and a little more push in the direction of a healthy middle ground between job difficulty and fight difficulty rather than the heavily skewed experience we have at the moment. But I expect that would take multiple expansions to come to fruition, much in the same way that it took multiple expansions to become an issue in the first place. As FF14 players, we're growing, and as developers, the Square Enix team is growing. With just a few weeks until the media tour kicks off, I really, really can't wait to see what's going to happen. Thank you so much for watching, and have a fantastic rest of your week.